Alright. Sorry I haven't done a video in a while, but I've been go school full time and work full time, so it keeps me pretty busy. But over the winter, I watched a few videos on map reading or using a map, and I'm not saying they were bad videos. I just think they were incomplete. The concept of backstops and rails is a good concept. Intentionally veering off to one side or the other, again, a good concept. That way you only have to look in one direction. You don't have to look, did I veer too far to the right or did I veer too far to the left? You know you veered one way or the other, so it makes it a little bit easier to find your destination. But there's a series of terrain features that are listed on a map, and they're all dictated by either lines and the color of the lines. That roads are black or red. Buildings, man-made structures are black. Water is blue. Swamps tend to have a little line with a little, almost like a little eyebrow that typically indicates a swamp. Green indicates vegetation. There's a heavy brown line and a light brown line. Those are called contour lines. Now, the heavy is what's called a contour, and then the light brown is called an intermittent contour. And on most maps, on the main contour lines, the contour lines are 20 meters apart between interval, or between the intermediate and the main contour lines. You got roughly 20 meters. Now, some maps vary differently, but most are based off the 20 meter contour line. But you can look down here underneath where it tells you mileage or yards or meters, and it will tell you what each contour line represents. And then if you look at the heavy ones and you track them long enough, you will actually find an elevation marking. Now, you can use those to determine whether where you're headed is going uphill or downhill. And if the lines are close together, it tells you that it's an extremely steep grade. If they're far apart, it's a shallow grade, and so on. But that's not the purpose of my video today. Most of that is found in the legends on a map. Now, first, contour, in the military, we used to use a simple method to remember our terrain features, and it was the fist, because each knuckle represented a mountaintop or a hilltop. Each space in between represented what was called a saddle. Well, to have a saddle, you have to have a multiple of mountaintops or hilltops, which means you have a ridgeline, which is all your knuckles in a line. That's your ridge line. Another terrain feature is a spur, which is the finger. In other words, it comes down off the hill, but it's the high portion going downhill. The in between the fingers is what's called a draw. It's similar to a valley, but it's the low spot in between hilltops along a ridge, and it's typically where water channels down. It's not actually a valley, though. Valleys typically go between ridge lines, not up a ridge line. So you have, here we go, here, this is a depression. Just basically a hole in the ground, easy one to remember. But this would be your valley. You've got a ridge on this side, and you've got a ridge on this side. So that's the way we used to remember when we were in the military, as far as what the actual names were. Now, maps actually have three different norths. Some only have two. Some only have true north and magnetic north. Other ones have true north, grid north, and magnetic north. Now, true north is true north. That's the North Pole. Magnetic north is actually underneath of Ellesmere Island in Canada. And magnetic north tends to move at roughly 40 miles a year to the northwest. Now, it used to be 20 miles a year, but it's recently picked up. Probably, I want to say it was in the middle 1900s, like 1950, 1940, something like that. The rate at which the magnetic north moved picked up. and it's now 40 miles per year. Some say it's because we're getting ready for a magnetic polar shift and all that, but that I don't know. But the reason that's important, now let me go back. You have true north, then you have magnetic north, but then you have grid north. And what that is on, let me switch maps here. You have grid squares. Now each square is a perfect square. Well, you can't have that on the Earth itself, on a true sphere, because the further toward the North Pole you get, the narrower the top of that square will be. And if you're headed toward the, if you're below the equator, the closer you get to the South Pole, the narrower that bottom portion will be. But for ease of measurements, what they did with maps, which is just a two-dimensional representation, they did create a perfect square. Now, if you look on maps that have, let's see if I've got one that shows it a little bit better. Zoom in a little bit here. Now, you have magnetic north, you have true north, and you have grid north. Now, unless you're using a protractor, you're really not going to use grid north. But let's go back to what I was doing here. Now, my main reason for doing this is my oldest map. It is about 10 years old when I bought it. I'm telling you when I bought it, not the age of the data. The age of the data is in the bottom right-hand corner on some maps. In other maps, like this one, it's right here in the center. Right here in the center. Oops, I'm lying right here. Right there. But the reason I'm doing this video, and it has to do with the fact that everybody talks about declinating your compass, but nobody actually explains the declination and where it comes from. Other than to say it is the offset between magnetic north and true north. But the problem is magnetic north is moving. So today, well, this map here was actually surveyed in 1955. Now, the rate at which it's moving, every between 4 and 5 years, you have a full degree of shift. That means that, like on here, it was, at the time this one was done, it was 4 degrees from true to magnetic. In 1955. This one, actually I bought, oh, I want to say that was 6 or 7 years ago. But even it is dated 1951. This one dated 1950. So that's when these declinations were good. Now, here is a map that I got when my boys and I went to Picture Rocks National Lakeshore, and it is more of a tourist map, which as you can see, they've only got the data up here on the lakeshore. All this stuff is left blank. But this is a newer map. This one here is probably only 4 or 5 years old. But even then, this one was done in 1996. Now, I have to do a shout out. This map, I heard about from Equip to Endure. And it is, I got it from mytopo.com. Now this map, and this map, actually this is actually over here, And then this one here would be right here. Now, I went online and I ordered this. And it said it would take 24 hours to ship, which I got the email that it shipped less than 24 hours after I ordered, but it would take, because I went normal postal service, that it would take 5 to 7 days to get. I got this in 2 days. So I have to say kudos to mytopo.com. I mean, they're on top of it, but it gets better than that. Like I said, this map here is here. This map here is here. This one is 1950. This one is 1951 that the data came from. Now, back up here. On this map, the true to magnetic north declination is 2.5 degrees. On this map, the true to magnetic north is 8 degrees, even though they're the same map. That's my point, the rate at which magnetic north is shifting. If I was still using this map, I'm 5.5 degrees off. Every degree that you're off over 1,000 yards is 17 yards. So over a mile, you're almost 30 yards off at a mile. That's for 1 degree. Now we're 5.5 degrees. So we're what, 165 yards off at 1 mile. So the further you get, the more that's gonna go up. Now all you gotta do is go on to NOAA's website, National Oceanographic and Atmospheric Administration, is what I believe it stands for. But go to NOAA and on there, locate declination constant. That's what this is called, is the declination constant. And you can either punch in where you're going or punch in the zip code of where you're going or where you are, and it will tell you what the declination is. So even if I was using this one, I could go to NOAA and I would find out that the declination is 8 degrees, not 2.5 degrees. So instead of using 8 degrees, I mean 2.5 degrees, I would use 8 degrees for all of my conversions to go from my magnetic to my grid, or my true north. Now, what that means is, if I were to use the 2.5 degree on this one, I would be 5.5 degrees too far to the east. So I may think that I'm banking left or banking west, when in reality, I'm banking east. And now I think I'm west, so I'm gonna start walking east to find my location, because I'm using that drift and that backstop and that handrail, and I end up too far over to the west, and then I start searching, to the east, and then I start searching to the east, and I never come to my target. Now, if I put my correct declination, then I will hit my intended target. So that was my whole point in this video. I am not saying that the others, I don't want to mention any names, because I thought the idea of backstop stops and handrails was a great idea. It makes sense. It makes map reading easier. If you have a handrail, you can follow that road or that creek or that ridge line until you come to that backstop that you've chosen, whether it's an electric line, a railroad line, whatever it may be, and then you've got to go right. So it is a good concept, nothing wrong with it. I like it. But I just wanted to make you aware of the differences with the declination constant and how to find it and how to use it. But again, I want to say kudos to mytopo.com and thank Equipped to Endure for turning me on to this. I mean, this is a laminated one, so I can use a dry erase marker on it to do what I want to do. So that's all I've got for this one. Thanks for watching and have a good one.